The Tom Woods Show, episode 797.
Prepare to set fire to the index card of allowable opinion. Your daily dose of liberty education starts here. The Tom Woods Show.
Folks, don't be envious of me just because I'm getting the best shave of my life. Join me. Get your free trial set from Harry's. That's a razor, five-blade cartridge, and shaving gel. Plus, they're tossing in a post-shave balm. And all you gotta do is pay three smackers for shipping. So head over to harrys.com. That's H-A-R-R-Y-S.com. And enter code Woods. Hi, everybody. Tom Woods here. Well, with the recent death of Fidel Castro, good heavens, Facebook has not been a safe place to be if you have friends across ideological lines, because, oh my goodness, are tears being shed for Fidel Castro, of all people, for heaven's sake. So let's get to the bottom of the true Castro legacy, the true history of Castro, what the whole story was in Cuba, and we're going to do that with Umberto Fontova, who is the author of Fidel, Hollywood's Favorite Tyrant, as well as The Longest Romance, the Mainstream Media, and Fidel Castro. TomWoods.com/797 is where to go to get links to those books. And then stay tuned after my conversation with Umberto. I'm going to add a little bit of additional information I learned from Yuri Maltsev about Castro. But for now, I'm very glad to welcome Umberto to the show. Thanks for being here.
Hey, great to be here, amigo. Thanks for the invite. Anytime.
All right. Look, I'm a little bit behind schedule here. I don't plan to have tyrants die. You know, I got the show planned out in advance, you know. But look, hey, better late than never. We got a lot of time to reflect, you know, all the rest of the time to reflect on this guy. So I've read several of your books on the general subject of Castro or Cuba. And, okay, I mean, we knew he had to die at some point. It happened recently. When you look back on his legacy, if you're on Fox News and they're giving you a 30-second soundbite to sum up this guy, how would you do it?
Well, like I told MSNBC, Fox invited me, but it was that Sunday morning, and I was last Sunday morning, and I was duck hunting. Hey, priorities, Tom, duck hunting. You know,
yeah. Heck, look,
I don't have time to go on these nonsense Fox shows when I'm going duck hunting. But as I told MSNBC when they made allowances for my hunt, we're talking about a regime. We're not talking about the little banana republic. You know, we're talking about a regime, a Stalinist regime that jailed and tortured political prisoners at a higher rate. Obviously not in absolute numbers. Cuba only had a population of 7 million. At a higher rate than Stalin's regime during the height of the Great Terror. At one point in 1961, 62, early 60s, one of every 17 Cubans was a political prisoner. That's right up there with Stalin. They murdered more political prisoners in their first 3 years in power than Hitler's regime murdered in its first 7 years in power. And they drove 20 times, folks, if you get nothing else out of this show, 20 times as many people to die trying to escape Cuba as have died trying to escape East Germany. And hey, you know something? East Germany had free healthcare too.
All right, we'll get to free healthcare in a minute. But let's talk about your own personal story, because you were born in Cuba and your family left, I guess, in 1961. Can you describe the circumstances?
Yeah, it was by the standards of the time, we had it relatively easy, but I do tell a story. We were leaving. We were at the airport. Me, my mom, my dad, my brother, and my sister. My sister's 8. My brother's 5. And I'm 7. And we're getting ready to board a plane. And the commies did this all the time. So just as we're getting ready to board the plane, oh my goodness, we're finally doing it. We're finally getting out of here. Two soldiers come out and they grab my dad and they start dragging him off. And at that time, by the way, hundreds of men and boys were being murdered by firing squad. Weekly, not executed, because an execution implies a judicial process, murdered by firing squad weekly. So we figured he's going to get shot. So my mom goes, if you're not coming with us, then we're not leaving either. And just before they dragged my dad through the doors, he turned around and he said, you are leaving because whatever happens to me, and remember, we thought he was going to the firing squad, I don't want my children growing up in a communist country. They dragged him through. My mom somehow sucked it up. Let's go, kids. We're going on our vacation. to visit our aunt in Miami, who already had relatives in Miami who had left a bit earlier. So I just remember getting on a plane with people weeping, mostly women and children, because they were doing this to a lot of the men, the ones who weren't in prison yet. So we get to Miami and we go to my aunt's house, and my mom rushes to the phone and calls Cuba. Where's Humberto? That's my dad's name. What happened? What happened? And I'll remember she went, I know. She dropped the phone and fainted. My aunt came running up, grabbed the phone, picked it up. She also screams, I know. What they heard was that my father was at a secret police headquarters, the G2 headquarters, where they were torturing and murdering the political prisoners. So I imagine my mom said, well, I'm in a country without a penny to my name. By the way, folks, everyone left Cuba with the clothes on their back, and they were happy to do it. The communists stole everything you owned. So she says, I don't have a penny in my name. I have three children to somehow school, raise, feed. I'm in a country where I don't know too many people and barely know the language. On top of that, it also appears that I am now a widow. So I guess it was too much for her. But somehow she sucked it up. A few weeks later, we moved to New Orleans, where we had even closer relatives and friends. And folks, when you leave a country with the clothes on your back, you want to go someplace where you really have close friends, you know? Okay, so we get to New Orleans, and we're living there for a few months. Phone rings. My mom picks it up. We're living at another aunt's house, and she screams again. But it was a scream of joy. It was my father calling from New Orleans International Airport. Can somebody please come pick me up? So we somehow scrounged up a car. Somebody must have had a car in our circle of family and friends. And we went to the airport and we picked up my father. And that was at the time, this was 60, when it was a Constellation. And that's when the plane stopped out and they went and they put the ladder type deal, the stairs up against it, and the people walked out. I'll never forget my dad walking down and my mom running across the tarmac, and I'll never forget that hug. So again, that was 1961, late 61. Last weekend and this weekend, my dad's birthday is tomorrow, by the way. He will be hunting and fishing with his children and grandchildren. Ours had a happy ending, folks. Tens of thousands of Cuban-American families did not.
Your father, I just have to point out the justice in all this. Your father outlived Castro, not simply because he's still alive today, but also because he lived to be older than Castro. Is he turning 91?
No, he's turning 90.
Oh, is he turning 90?
Yeah, he's turning. So he was like, Castro was about 4 months older than him.
All right.
Castro made 90 in August. Okay. My dad makes 90 in December.
All right, and he's out there super active, which is absolutely great.
Super active, hunting and fishing, you know, like if he was my age.
All right, now tell me, what kinds of things did somebody have to do to get into trouble in Castro's Cuba? Bearing in mind that under Stalin, it didn't have to be anything. That was precisely the nature of the terror, that at least you could say to yourself, well, I'm not actively organizing against Stalin, so I have nothing to worry about. He kept everybody on his toes by going after innocent people. So what was going on in Castro's Cuba?
Well, that was the whole point. In fact, they went after innocent people sometimes on purpose to terrorize. Che Guevara mentioned this in his book. He said, you apply terror. So a lot of these executions that were televised, people get all horrified over ISIS. Folks, Castro and Che Guevara beat ISIS by 60 years. They were televising, videoing firing squad murders in January of 1959, precisely for the same reason as ISIS is doing. But the media didn't report that. The media doesn't report that. So most Americans think that it's ISIS who started this practice. It started 90 miles from our shores, folks, by the guy who's hailed by thousands of celebrities and patrician Americans. 90 miles away, but a lot of these executions were precisely of innocent people. There was no due process in Cuba, precisely to terrorize. Look, if you dare mess with us, if you don't join us in this revolution, this is what could happen to you.
How do you answer the claim that is very, very common? I mean, it's mainstream historians, it's the media, it's everybody. And they claim that at first, Castro was simply a wide-eyed nationalist full of love for his country. But then he was spurned by the U.S., so he had no choice but to fall into the arms of the Soviet Union and become a communist only then. Is your view that he was a commie all along?
He was a commie all along. That is so bogus, and it astounds me that people still spew that lie. Raul Castro had a KGB handler since 1954. His name was Nikolai Leonov. This is all thoroughly documented in my books. The mainstream media and Fidel Castro, the longest romance. Fidel, Hollywood's favorite tyrant. Che Guevara gets arrested in Mexico City in 1956. He has got the card of Nikolai Leonov in his wallet. So right after Raul introduced Che to Nikolai Leonov, both of them had KGB handlers years before the Cuban Revolution. Fidel himself had contacts with Soviet diplomatic personnel in Cuba from 1948 at the University of Havana when he was my dad's University of Havana classmate. So this is so idiotic. As a matter of fact, the United States bent over backwards trying to accommodate Castro. The CIA was completely snookered by Castro. I've got quotes from them. By the way, the CIA is very, very mad at me for publishing this book, especially a CIA agent named Robert Chapman, who was the CIA station chief in Santiago, Cuba, denounced my book viciously in the International Journal of Intelligence, but he did not address any of the issues. I have got quotes from the CIA in this book saying, everyone in the CIA and everyone in the U.S. State Department were pro-Castro. This is sworn congressional testimony from the U.S. ambassador to Cuba at the time, Earl Smith. Robert Reynolds, who was the Caribbean chief for the CIA in the late 50s, early 60s, said, me and my staff were all Fidelistas. So the U.S. accommodation of Castro, groveling before Castro, contributing money to Castro, started before he was even in power. The CIA delivered checks, signed checks, to Fidel Castro's revolutionary movement in Cuba. This is documented in my books. So I brought all this out, and boy, did this upset the CIA, especially the CIA guy who was the guy doing it. But he did not refute any of the quotes that I had in here, any of the facts that I had. He just said, well, Fontova's trying to rewrite history. Can you be a little more specific, Mr. Chapman? How? Refute what I put in this book. And he couldn't do it. So we started accommodating Castro from day one. Castro gets into power in January of 1959. How many of our viewers and listeners realize that the U.S. gave diplomatic recognition, benediction, in other words, to the Castro regime more rapidly than they had recognized Batista's regime, the so-called U.S.-supported dictator? They recognized Castro in record time. They had never given diplomatic benediction to a Latin American country as quickly as they gave that benediction to Fidel Castro. They quickly lavished the Castro government with $200 million in sugar subsidies from the U.S. taxpayers. Arturo Frondizi, Argentine president in the early 60s, and he recounts in his memoirs how all during 1959 and 1960, the U.S. made a total of 16 back-channel attempts. He was the conduit to try to accommodate Castro, to try to figure out the source of his tantrums, because they were still too stupid to realize he was being handled by the KGB.
Okay, so Eisenhower recognizes the new regime?
Yeah, Ike, it was all under Ike. See, Cuba fell to communism. It's a terrible thing. And the problem was the State Department, the fourth floor of the State Department that was in charge of Latin America and the CIA. Eisenhower, part of his genius was delegating. But when it came to Latin America, he delegated to the wrong people. Well, and let's be practical. In the late 50s, early 1960, up in the 60s, Berlin was a crisis point. You know, 56, you know, you had the Hungarian Revolution. 56, you had the Suez Crisis. Who would have dreamed that this would have happened, in fairness to them? Who would have dreamed that the Soviet Union had set their sights on Cuba? So that's in fairness to them, but it was under Ike. But the U.S. bent over backwards to accommodate Castro, both as a guerrilla and as a chief executive and as a dictator. The U.S. could not have done more to try to accommodate Castro.
All right, but that's between – okay, so early January 1959, he gets recognition from the U.S. But by October 1960 – Eisenhower is putting a ban on exports to Cuba. So what happens between the one time and the other?
Minor detail. Castro walks into every U.S.-owned property in Cuba in July of 60, June in 60, and steals $8 billion from U.S. stockholders and businessmen at Soviet gunpoint and murders and tortures the few Americans who resisted. Howard Anderson is one of them. And it's documented in my book. What they did is they took him in and they drew the blood from his body first. This was in a court case where the Anderson family was seeking restitution. What they were doing, so much blood was spilling into Cuban soil from all the firing squad murders that the Cuban regime started extracting most of the blood prior to tying him to the stake so they could sell it on the international market. Howard Anderson had most of the blood drawn from his body, and he was sent to the firing squad. This is what was happening to U.S. citizens, folks, along with Cubans, who resisted the theft of U.S. property at Soviet gunpoint. So what are you going to do? Castro steals $8 billion from U.S. businessmen in Cuba. It was $2 billion at the time. It's worth $8 billion now, the claims at the State Department. So the U.S. says, okay, well, what are we going to do? Any businessman who gets robbed blind in the night is going to go, well, we're not going to give this guy credit, are we? So that is why the so-called embargo was put in place in the first place, folks. Ike didn't wake up on the wrong side of the bed and said, I'm going to punish that little spit guy. No, they stole at gunpoint and murdered U.S. citizens. And that is why they put sanctions in place, sanctions that have not really been in place for about the last 10 to 15 years.
All right, let's I want to talk about health and literacy and all that, but let's first thank our sponsor. Here's a challenge for you. How do you find somebody a gift that that person can actually use, but also has a personal touch and isn't just another figurine or thing from the dollar store or collectible that nobody in his right mind collects? What do you do? Answer, you get the Harry's Holiday Shave Set. You can get the Midnight Blue Chrome Razor Handle engraved with your recipient's initials. They get three of the five-blade cartridges that give you such a great shave. I mean, remember, I love this thing. I use them constantly, and I don't wind up a bloody mess the way I used to when I used to use a blade. You also get a foaming shave gel, smells great, beautiful gift box, great gift. You won't be hated. You'll be loved for this gift. 30 smackers at harrys.com, but you can take five smackers off your order when you use coupon code WOODS. So check it out at harrys.com and make sure and use coupon code WOODS. Free shipping ends December 9th, so act fast. harrys.com and take off $5 with coupon code WOODS. All right, before we get to the literacy and health things, I do want to say a few words about your books and get some stuff out of there. In particular, you have focused on Hollywood and on the mainstream media in their sympathy for and portrayals of Castro. And it's just sickening to listen to this. They portrayed, I mean, I don't care what people's opinions are of Donald Trump, but to think that Castro was better or Trump would be more dangerous than Castro, I don't fear, you know, I fear there might be some bad economic policy, but I don't fear firing squads, for heaven's sake. under Trump. But there's all this crazy nonsense coming out ever since Castro died. Talk about the mainstream media's treatment of Castro.
Well, and it's not just, see, here's what happens. Why is it that so little is known about the revolution? Why is it that most of the things that I'm telling our viewers and listeners tonight are somewhat shocking to folks? They don't know it. And it's explained in this book, the mainstream media and Fidel Castro, they started cultivating when there were still guerrillas in the hills. Here's a quote from Fidel Castro from 1958. Propaganda is the heart of our struggle. We can never abandon propaganda. Che Guevara's diaries, an entry from 1958, he said, much more important than guerrilla recruits for our guerrilla army were U.S. media recruits to help spread our propaganda. That started in 1958, folks. And, you know, you can somewhat excuse them in 58, 57, 59, because really it wasn't clear what Castro was up to. Let's go ahead and give him a pass for that, Tom. But, folks, 60 years later, they're still at it. You know, you would really think that a few things had happened in the last 60 years that would cause people to question. And what happens is that you don't get a Havana Bureau, Tom. You don't get a Havana Bureau, ABC, CNN, they all have them. You don't get one unless you're going to play the regime's game. I have to keep reminding myself that it's been, you know, a whole generation has come up since the Iron Curtain fell. Cuba is an Iron Curtain country, folks. In the 40s, the 50s, and 60s, if you were getting a report from East Berlin, from Prague, from Moscow, from Budapest, most Americans were like, well, good grief, this is being doctored by communists. You know, this is part of a propaganda ministry of the communist country. But people somehow don't think of that when they see an ABC report from Havana, an Associated Press report. And it's the same thing. The reporters who get to Cuba, if they get a journalist visa, they are essentially going to be a propaganda auxiliary of the Castro regime. It's as simple as that. I quote a Spanish, Vicente Rotin, a Spanish reporter for El País, and he also worked for a Madrid TV station, who refused to play the game. And he documents it, how the regime, first of all, they vet you completely before they issue your journalist visa. And at the time, he wasn't looking. But he got to Cuba, and he saw what was actually going on in Cuba. And he says, wow, why is none of this being reported? I can't believe the lies I grew up believing about Cuba, the health care, the embargo, blah, blah, blah. So he started reporting the truth. Boom! He was out of there in a week. That's why so much BS is believed worldwide about Cuba, starting from the revolution to the health care.
Well, let's talk about that, because that's come up quite a bit. And also the literacy rate is supposed to be slightly higher than in the U.S. Now, I'm going to ask you about that. But even if that were true, my view would be, what are they allowed to read? If I were running a communist dictatorship, I wouldn't care if everybody was literate if all they could read was communist propaganda.
No, certainly they're not allowed to read these books. I'll tell you that. My books are obviously banned. But so is the U.N. Declaration of Human Rights banned. Animal Farm is banned. Folks, I can't stress it enough. It is a Stalinist Iron Curtain regime. In 1958, Cuba had 88% literacy. Now, what you've got to remember is that Cuba had only been an independent nation since 1902. It had been utterly devastated in its war of liberation. Americans know it. It's a Spanish-American war, but it had actually started several years before U.S. guerrillas, Cuban guerrillas fighting Spain. So Cuba was completely demolished, devastated. In 1902, they get there and they start. So all of these advances that you're going to be hearing about from me took place in a course, basically about the same amount of time that Castro's been in power, about 55 years. Cuba had 88% literacy. Cuba spent the most on literacy, on education. You can see from the budget, this is documented in my books, than any country in Latin America. Cuba had a higher standard of living in 1958 than much of Europe. Cubans owned as many cars per capita in 1958 as the fanatical car freaks, the Italians. Cuba in 1958 had almost double Spain's per capita income. It had a higher per capita income than Austria, than Japan. It had a lower infant mortality than France, Germany, and Belgium. And this is documented, by the way, by the United States. And this was at a time when Cuba was not a totalitarian country. So the figures were given to the United Nations by people who were not, did not have a gun to their head, like Batista. As a matter of fact, most of these figures that I'm giving you were being given to the United Nations, and they were given to international institutions by Cubans who were actually anti-Batistas. Most educated upper-tier Cubans were anti-Batista. My family wasn't. My country was indifferent. Hey, Batista didn't mess with us. You know, it's typical of these so-called right-wing dictators. Like I told Soledad O'Brien last week, she was a guest on MSNBC. She was talking about, I said, who jumped on rafts to escape from Batista? Under Batista's rule in the 1950s, folks, more Americans lived in Cuba than Cubans lived in the U.S. And this was at a time that Cubans could leave Cuba with all of their possessions, get a U.S. visa for the ass. Cuba took in more immigrants as a percentage of population before Castro in the 20th century than did the United States, including the Ellis Island years. So we went from being one of the world's biggest magnets for immigrants to one where 20 times as many people have died trying to escape it than East Germany. What more can you say?
How would you account then for, but let's say something about the health situation. Don't they have great free health care?
It's dreadful. In 1958, they had a great base to work on. In 1958, Cuba had the 13th lowest infant mortality on Earth. Nowadays, this is a good example. Most of the doctors, or the men who became women who became doctors, who had the misfortune of being born in Cuba in the 50s and 60s and got their medical degrees under Castro, when they come to the United States, escaping and otherwise, they cannot pass. They obviously have to be licensed in the U.S. to be practiced. They cannot pass the exam in the United States to be doctors. They can barely pass the one. Most of them flunk the ones to be doctor's assistants. Bottom line, most Cuban doctors, as the media and the UN and liberals call it, barely qualify as U.S. nurses. It is a complete hoax. Let me give you an example of how this works. Remember Michael Moore's Sicko, Tom?
Yeah.
Yeah, remember when that movie? Obviously, that was one of Castro's favorite movies. It was shown island-wide for free in Cuba, and Cuban dissidents saw that movie, and they were horrified. They were disgusted. Here we go again. Propaganda, and the world's going to believe this like they believe the rest of the propaganda believe. And don't you know that Cuban dissidents snuck little mini cameras into actual Cuban hospitals? Not the ones that the Communist Party elite and tourists use, but the ones that Joe Sixpack Cuban uses it. Not that most Cubans can even afford a six-pack, but the ones that the regular Cubans have to go, they snuck cameras into them, and they snuck out films of horrible conditions, fly-infested beds without sheets, just horrible, horrible conditions. And they were going to show it on ABC. John Stossel was going to show it back when he was on ABC. And the show was going to be What Michael Moore Didn't Show You. And we all went, wow, wow, this is great. I was getting briefed on this by my friends who are friends with Cuban dissidents. This is going to be great. Well, guess what? The regime got wind of this, and they called in the ABC people in Havana. This is, shows you how they manipulate. And they said, you know, if y'all do this, if y'all show these, we're really going to have to reconsider the renewal of your Havana Journalist Bureau. So in other words, they blackmailed them. They were going to boot him, just like they booted Vicente Botín for showing the truth. ABC, John Stossel, caved. They caved. They showed a very – they did show a show, but they didn't show the most hard-hitting parts of those films. The dissidents call my friends in Miami and say, Umberto, this is horrible. These dissidents in Cuba generally, literally almost – risk their lives to get these films out. We smuggle them to the U.S., and what's going to happen? ABC caved. I said, hold on for a second, folks. Hold on, but let's not despair. This is in 2009-8. Hold on, let me go. Let me call somebody who doesn't have a Havana Bureau. So I called Hannity's producers, and I called O'Reilly's producers. And they called back immediately, told them what I had. But Hannity's producers called a little quickly, more quickly than did Hannity's. And Hannity showed it, folks. And you can see it, showed it. And you can see it on YouTube. Hannity, what Michael Moore didn't show you. But that goes to show you how they manipulate the U.S. media. Fox didn't have a Havana Bureau, so they had nothing to lose. ABC did, so they were going to be a typical propaganda auxiliary of the regime.
But I can understand why the media is that way, because, as you say, they can't get access otherwise. How do we explain away all the actors and actresses in Hollywood?
Well, where do they get their news? You know, and by the way, again, you know, they're not going to get a Havana visa. They're going to not going to get a so-called tourist or a cultural visit visa without playing the regime's game. What it is, people want to believe this. They want to believe it. You know, hey, that's the guy who poked the eye of Uncle Sam. So he's cool. As I mentioned, as we heard a little earlier, as I told you in his documentary, he did nothing but poke. In fact, he was put in power by Uncle Sam. And Uncle Sam did his, you know, that's another thing. He defied 11 U.S. presidents. Folks, I told you earlier how the U.S. helped put him in power. In 1959, August of 1959, anti-communist Cubans mounted a plot to get rid of Castro and to kill him, because the people involved in this plot knew him from his Soviet, knew the Soviet, and they said the only way we're going to save our country is to kill Castro and the top leadership and stuff. August of 59. These anti-communist Cubans knew how Castro had taken power, so they did not alert the U.S. to this. Good grief, no. Well, the U.S. got wind of it anyway. And the U.S. ambassador to Cuba, Philip Bonsal was his name, actually alerted the Castro regime to this plot, and they grabbed them and they imprisoned and tortured the plotters, thanks to the U.S. ambassador to Cuba. Comes the missile crisis. What do we hear in the news? Oh, gosh, Kennedy stood up to the Russians. Oh, that was so cool how Khrushchev blinked. Total poppycock. In his own memoirs, Khrushchev says, we got exactly what we wanted from Kennedy. Security for Castro regime and U.S. missiles removed from Turkey and Italy. Now, the deal that Kennedy signed with Khrushchev said, we promise not to invade Cuba, if you get the missiles out of Cuba, Khrushchev is going to get them out anyway. But here's the part that people will mention. We also promise to prevent anyone else in the Western Hemisphere from molesting the Castro regime. So in effect, after October of 1962, the United States became the Castro regime's protector. By treaty, as late as 1983, this was in effect. I knew people who were involved with helping the Nicaraguan Contras at the time. And so they said, and remember, you know, the Reagan administration was helping fight communism in Nicaragua and El Salvador and so forth. And they said, great, we're doing this here. Now, when we finish in Nicaragua and Salvador, can we go to the source of the problem in Cuba? And there's an interview in my book with Elliot Abrams where he mentions that, no, we cannot go to the source. And hinting around, beating around the bush, it was the Kennedy-Khrushchev pact that would prevent it. So far from defying the U.S., as the media and idiots constantly say about Castro, he hid behind the U.S.'s skirts.
I want to urge people to check out your books, Umberto, because first of all, they're going to love all the information in them, but they're also going to enjoy reading them because they're written the same way you give interviews, all right? So if you enjoyed this episode, you're really going to like them. The ones in particular that are relevant to what we're talking about is Fidel, Hollywood's Favorite Tyrant, and The Longest Romance, the Mainstream Media and Fidel Castro. You're going to get a lot of great stuff in there. I'm going to link to them at tomwoods.com/797. And Umberto's
My website is hfontova.com.
I was just going to ask you, how do people follow you?
Yeah. If you put either Umberto with an H in the front, because the Italian doesn't have the H, the Spanish with H, or Fontova into Google, my website's the first thing that comes up. And all of my weekly columns and all of my books are linked there. Thank you.
All right, hfontova.com. I'm also going to link to that on the show notes page. I love how you got that Ted Nugent blurb right there on the front of the homepage.
Uncle Ted, he's helped me a lot.
That's just great. Well, thanks so much for your time. I mean, people were begging me to do this episode, so we finally got to it. And they are going to be so glad when this one comes out. It's one of my favorites ever. Thanks so much.
And I came in early from a duck hunt to accommodate it because I was tickled to be on this with you, buddy. Thanks a lot.
You are such a good man, Umberto. Thanks again.
Okay, thanks.
All right. I'm also going to add to tomwoods.com/797 an article that appeared at Mises.org several days ago by Yuri Maltsev, who's been on the show a couple of times. He is a defector. He was a Soviet defector to the United States back about, I guess, 27 years ago, something like that, 28 years ago maybe. And he has an article on Castro, and it's called Fidel Castro, Hero or Cold-Blooded Murderer. You're going to want to read this thing. But in particular, just because we were talking about standard of living toward the end, I want to amplify what we said by sharing with you something that appeared in Yuri's article. He says, the complete lack of reliable statistics makes it impossible to offer any exact numbers on the state of the Cuban economy. And then he said that after his travels, where he's been to over 80 countries, he would compare Cuba to, say, Malawi in terms of standard of living based on his own visual approximation. He says Guatemala, with its $3,800 per capita GDP, looks like a superpower compared to Cuba. So he says, you look at all these crazy figures that are handed out in terms of per capita GDP on Cuba. He says, none of this makes any sense. None of it corresponds to your actual lived experience when you actually look around and go there. He said, much closer to the truth is what we find in the survey and the work and research done by Boston Consulting Group. He says, Boston Consulting Group surveyed the purchasing power of Cuban households and found that about half the Cuban population lives with a median household income of $300 to $400 a year, while another half of Cuban consumers in urban areas had a household income of $1,000 to $2,000 a year. So that's footnoted. So that is going to also be linked at tomwoods.com/797. So check that out as the indispensable companion to this episode, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Become a smarter libertarian in just 30 minutes a day. Visit tomwoods.com to subscribe to the show for free, and we'll see you next time.